Blackstone Audiobooks presents
The Age of Chivalry, or Legends of King Arthur, by Thomas Bulfinch. Throngs of knights and barons bold, in weeds of peace high triumphs hold, with store of ladies, whose bright eyes rain influence and judge the prize. Milton. Preface. In a former work, the compiler of this volume endeavored to impart the pleasures of classical learning to the English reader by presenting the stories of pagan mythology in a form adapted to modern taste. In the present volume, the attempt has been made to treat in the same way the stories of the second Age of Fable, the age which witnessed the dawn of the several states of modern Europe. It is believed that this presentation of a literature which held unrivaled sway over the imaginations of our ancestors for many centuries will not be without benefit to the reader, in addition to the amusement it may afford. The tales, though not to be trusted for their facts, are worthy of all credit as pictures of manners, and it is beginning to be held that the manners and modes of thinking of an age are a more important part of its history than the conflicts of its peoples, generally leading to no result. Besides this, the literature of romance is a treasure house of poetical material, to which modern poets frequently resort. The Italian poets, Dante and Ariosto, the English, Spenser, Scott, and Tennyson, and our own Longfellow and Lowell, are examples of this. These legends are so connected with each other, so consistently adapted to a group of characters strongly individualized in Arthur, Lancelot, and their compeers, and so lighted up by the fires of imagination and invention, that they seem as well adapted to the poet's purpose as the legends of the Greek and Roman mythology. And if every well-educated young person is expected to know the story of the Golden Fleece, why is the quest of the Song Grail less worthy of his acquaintance? Or if an allusion to the shield of Achilles ought not to pass unapprehended, why should one to Excalibur, the famous sword of Arthur? Of Arthur, who to upper light restored, with that terrific sword which yet he brandishes for future war, shall lift his country's fame above the polar star? Wordsworth. It is an additional recommendation of our subject that it tends to cherish in our minds the idea of the source from which we sprung. We are entitled to our full share in the glories and recollections of the land of our forefathers down to the time of colonization thence. The associations which spring from this source must be fruitful of good influences, among which, not the least valuable, is the increased enjoyment which such associations afford to the American traveler when he visits England and sets his foot upon any of her renowned localities. The readers of Tennyson are invited to peruse in these legends the originals of those stories which the poet has clothed in the drapery of verse, and given to the public in his Idylls of the King and in shorter poems. Perhaps some of them may be found more intelligible for our plain narrative of the same events. Thomas Bulfinch, Boston, 1858. Part 1. King Arthur and His Knights. Chapter 1. Introduction. On the decline of the Roman power, about 5 centuries after Christ, the countries of northern Europe were left almost destitute of a national government. Numerous chiefs, more or less powerful, held local sway as far as each could enforce his dominion, and occasionally those chiefs would unite for a common object. But in ordinary times, they were much more likely to be found in hostility to one another. In such a state of things, the rights of the humbler classes of society were at the mercy of every assailant, and it is plain that, without some check upon the lawless power of the chiefs, society must have relapsed into barbarism. Such checks were found, first, in the rivalry of the chiefs themselves, whose mutual jealousy made them restraints upon one another. Secondly, in the influence of the church, which, by every motive, pure or selfish, was pledged to interpose for the protection of the weak. And lastly, in the generosity and sense of right which, however crushed under the weight of passion and selfishness, dwell naturally in the heart of man. From this last source sprang chivalry, which framed an ideal of the heroic character, combining invincible strength and valor, justice, modesty, loyalty to superiors, courtesy to equals, compassion to weakness, and devotedness to the church. An ideal which, if never met with in real life, was acknowledged by all as the highest model for emulation. The word chivalry is derived from the French cheval, a horse. The word knight, which originally meant boy or servant, was particularly applied to a young man after he was admitted to the privilege of bearing arms. This privilege was conferred on youths of family and fortune only, for the mass of the people were not furnished with arms. The knight then was a mounted warrior, a man of rank, or in the service and maintenance of some man of rank, generally possessing some independent means of support, but often relying mainly on the gratitude of those whom he served for the supply of his wants, and often, no doubt, resorting to the means which power confers on its possessor. In time of war, the knight was, with his followers, in the camp of his sovereign, or commanding in the field, or holding some castle for him. In time of peace, he was often in attendance at his sovereign's court, gracing with his presence the banquets and tournaments with which princes cheered their leisure. Or he was traversing the country in quest of adventure, professedly bent on redressing wrongs and enforcing rights, sometimes in fulfillment of some vow of religion or of love. These wandering knights were called knights errant. They were welcome guests in the castles of the nobility, for their presence enlivened the dullness of those secluded abodes, and they were received with honor at the abbeys, which often owed the best part of their revenues to the patronage of the knights. But if no castle or abbey or hermitage were at hand, their hardy habits made it not intolerable to them to lie down supperless at the foot of some wayside cross and pass the night. It is evident that the justice administered by such an instrumentality must have been of the rudest description. The force whose legitimate purpose was to redress wrongs might easily be perverted to inflict them. Accordingly, we find in the romances, which, however fabulous in facts, are true as pictures of manners, that a knightly castle was often a terror to the surrounding country, that its dungeons were full of oppressed knights and ladies, waiting for some champion to appear to set them free, or to be ransomed with money, that hosts of idle retainers were ever at hand to enforce their lord's behests, regardless of law and justice, and that the rights of the unarmed multitude were of no account. This contrariety of fact and theory in regard to chivalry will account for the opposite impressions which exist in men's minds respecting it. While it has been the theme of the most fervid eulogium on one part, it has been as eagerly denounced on the other. On a cool estimate, we cannot but see reason to congratulate ourselves that it has given way in modern times to the reign of law, and that the civil magistrate, if less picturesque, has taken the place of the mailed champion. The Training of a Knight. The preparatory education of candidates.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.